I've been one since I can remember. I've studied different topics over the course of the year. And as a consequence of this, I ended up developing a fascination for obtaining knowledge. This was because I realized that our whole civilization is built on knowledge. Thanks to knowledge, we, as a species, have literally bent the world around us to our will. We extend our lives for decades using medicine, and we contain entire lakes using dams. All of it, from the room we're in to the clothes you're wearing, has been made possible thanks to the people who have rigorously studied the world around us. Scientists. They have dedicated their lives and their minds to a better understanding of the world we live in. But even though I love science, and I believe it is the way towards progress, I also believe that it does have limitations. That there are things that can't be described in a dictionary or calculated in complicated equations. Things that we all know and feel, but can never, ever dream of putting into words. At the beginning of this year, my Spanish teacher decided that a good exercise for my class to expand the vocabulary would be to bring definitions of words that she had assigned us last class. So, every class, my classmates would learn about the definitions of words that most of us didn't know until then. And I was amazed by how every definition fit the word perfectly. Until one day, I asked myself, what's love's definition? And no matter how hard I tried, I couldn't answer satisfactorily. My dear audience, if I asked you to define love, what would you answer? Some of you might say, love is the desire of taking care of someone. But if so, then what's the difference between love and loyalty? Others might say that love is enjoying someone's company. But if this were true, then how could we ever tell love and pleasure apart? I don't have an accurate definition of love, and chances are, neither do you. But every single person in this room knows love. We felt it. And sometimes, we can even see it. When a mother holds her child in her arms, or when a couple stares deep into each other's eyes, there it is, love, so thick in the air you could reach out and grab it. And yet, science can't give us an accurate definition of love. Picture this. You are a typical high school student. You spend your free time on the internet, listening to music, and hopefully, study. Everything's all right until one day, it hits you. You realize you have a crush on that cute girl from your chemistry class. You want to talk to her, but it turns out, you're not bold, and you struggle expressing yourself. And no matter how hard you try, you just can't find the right words to tell her how you feel. If this is the case, then you might suffer from alexithymia, the subclinical inability of identifying and expressing one's emotions. It is estimated that anywhere from 5 to 10% of the population suffers from this condition. So, are we doomed to an existence where nobody can say how we feel just because we can't find the right words? No. Lucky for us, there are other ways. Better ways of identifying and expressing feelings. Art is the single greatest tool we have of expressing and identifying feelings. Even if we can't describe love in a dictionary, we can still listen to music, admire paintings, or read literature that embodies love perfectly. In the words of the American painter, Edward Hopper, if I could say the words, then there would be no reason to paint it. And this doesn't just apply to love. It applies to every single sensation we experience. So, ladies and gentlemen, am I suggesting that you should ignore logic and science completely and only value your emotions as you skip cheerfully into the sunset with a flower in your hair? No. But in our world governed by concrete definitions, ones and zeros, and precise formulas, it's easy to overlook the importance and the complexity of our emotions. Do not commit that mistake. Do not lose sight of the importance of your emotions. Because it is this, above anything else, what makes you who you are.